Good evening, everyone. So we're continuing on in our series, looking at Revelation chapter 4 today. But we can't stop with just 4. We need to go a little further, but we'll have to stop at some point. So the place where we'll try to reach is chapter 5, verse 9. So we're looking at Revelation chapter 4 all the way until chapter 5, verse 9. When you look at, when you buy a new car, or even a used car, it comes with a car manual. And anytime you read that car manual, you know that you don't have to read the entire manual. You can just go and flip to the section that you want to learn about. And the way that these manuals are written, they're not particularly works of literary art. If you want to know how something works in the trunk, you can read about it and it tells you exactly where the hooks are so that you can secure the cargo. And then when it comes time to learn about how the seatbelts operate, these writers are not going to make all these allusions to how you should secure your precious cargo, your children, or whoever it is, using a similar sort of safety system. They just tell you very matter of fact. Oftentimes we read the Bible this way, and we can't take parts of the Bible by itself. It's a full story. It's a narrative. One of the nice things about the Bibles that we have is it has chapter divisions. It's very easy for me to say we're going to cover from here to here. But the problem is we might think that this is some sort of self-contained unit. When we start in chapter 4, there is this reference to a door, right? So there's a loud voice. After this, I looked and there in heaven is a door stood open. So we have to keep in mind that this is a continuation of what just happened. You know, Jesus was speaking a message to 7 churches, and the last of those churches, the church in Laodicea, to them he says, if anyone, I stand at the door knocking, if anyone hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. And so it seems as though when you take that and now connect it with chapter 4, the people aren't even given a chance to respond. The door has already now been opened. Now, in Genesis, in Revelation chapter 3, at the end, the metaphor is that Jesus stands at the door, and we're given the impression that he stands outside and he's waiting to come in. But here in chapter 4, Jesus is calling us to come in, and we're the ones outside. And both of these metaphors can be true at the very same time. When Jesus comes into our lives, we're also being brought into the very presence of God. And so that's what we see here. We're getting a glimpse into the heavenly throne room, and it is an impressive sight. It's too impressive to be able to describe, and so we have to use all sorts of wild language and allusions and metaphors, but this is the only way we can discuss this. What do? When you're seeing something for the first time that has no parallel to anything on earth, you have to communicate this, and so you need to use whatever comparisons you can come up with. And so there's this voice of Jesus that is this voice that sounds like a trumpet. And why do we think it's Jesus? Although in some Bibles, it might not be written if you have one of those red letter Bibles. These words may not be written in red letters, but it very well could be the same voice of the voice that was there in Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. And that voice turned out to be Jesus himself. And so you get this invitation, this personal invitation, and John is now being taken up in the spirit to the place where God is. Remember, in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, when we were listening to the words to the churches, Jesus is addressing the present hardship and the situation that's happening in the churches. Those current issues are being talked about, and if the people remain faithful, there is a promised reward that awaits all these people. And these rewards will show up, as we talked about last time, in Revelation chapter 21 and 22. But how do we get from the current situation of the churches in Revelation 2 and 3, when Jesus is speaking to the churches, to the future, to the then part of the story, that is Revelation chapter 21 and 22, where the rewards are received. How do we transition from the now to then? Or a better way of thinking of it, because really to transition from now to then requires no effort. Time always moves forward, at least for us as human beings. A better question to ask is, what will this experience between now and then look and feel like? That's the better question to ask. And if that's the question to ask, what is that experience going to look like? We need a right perspective. The perspective from below, from the earthly perspective, from the human perspective, is not going to be wide enough to encompass all that's to come. And so this invitation to John and to us to come into the throne room of God, it's essential, because without this invitation to be where God is, we won't be able to have the perspective that God wants us to have of all the things that are yet to come. So John is about to learn of the things that are to come. It says, I will show you what will take place after this. Now, here's a question that we need to ask. After this means what? Is this referring to the distant future? Are we talking about 10 years from now, 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now? Is this referring to tomorrow? Any moment after the immediate present? Well, I think sometimes we have a tendency of choosing one or the other. I think it's both. I think that we should not read the next portions from chapter 4 all the way to chapter 21 and 22. Don't read those as if they're talking about some distant future. These are all talking about things that need to happen after this, after the present, after those messages to the seven churches have been read. Once that's been read, we're in chapters 4 through 22 right now. So I think it's the near as well as the long-term future. So who gets to see this? Or who does he see in the throne room? There is obviously this person who is sitting on a throne. But just like in the Old Testament, anytime we try to look upon God, we just can't comprehend. We can't explain or express. God is beyond all definitions and all articulations. And so instead of describing what God looks like, instead we just get colors. And these colors come to us by way of common stones. Stones did not have just one color. And so there is this range, this brilliance of colors that we see before us. In verse 3, the one seated there looked like jasper and carnelian, and around the throne there is a rainbow that looks like emerald. And around the 24, so we have a brief mention that we'll get to later on, we see that there is a rainbow even there behind God. So when we read this, this might seem very suddenly strange, but this shouldn't be new to us at all, because we're all readers of the Old Testament. Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 26 to 28. Write it down in your notes. I'll just quickly read it, and you'll hear the similarities. Ezekiel, having a similar vision, says, "And above the dome of their heads, there was something like a throne, in appearance like sapphire. Seated above the likeness of a throne was something that seemed like a human form. Upward from what appeared like the loins, I saw something like gleaming amber, something that looked like fire enclosed all around. And downward from what looked like the loins, I saw something that looked like fire. And there was splendor all around, like the bow in a cloud on a rainy day. Such was the appearance of the splendor all around. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord." So the vision that John is having right now This is not a one-off vision. This is a vision that's been had before in the past by the prophets. Ezekiel sees God in this way, and even he struggles to express to us how beautiful it is to be in the presence of God. And here, this is why I keep saying, the more we read the Old Testament, the more prepared we will be for passages like this. Now, in verse 4, there's this interesting introduction, because not only is God there seated on the throne, but we seem to have a whole lot of other people. Verse 4 says that there around the throne are 24 thrones, and seated on those thrones are 24 elders, and they're dressed in white, and they have golden crowns on their heads. So if we remember what we've just read, some of the rewards that were mentioned to the seven churches are described here. People dressed in white, having crowns upon their heads. But now the question is, who are these 24? And we have to admit, it's not easy to say. Many scholars have come up with plenty of different plausible interpretations for this, but there's no consensus. I, after reading through quite a bit, I think what I find to be very helpful is noticing that the number 24, it's a multiple of 12. And every time we have the number 12, it's a symbol of the fullness, the completeness. 24 here, I think it has a great way of linking old and new together. It could be a representation of the 12 tribes along with the 12 apostles. That is, the Old Testament community of faith that was embodied in and through the nation of Israel, but then now you have the entire expanded ministry that comes after Jesus, which goes beyond the boundaries of geographic and national Israel, and that's embodied by the 12 apostles that go off and spread the word. So another reason why I think it makes sense to see this as a representation of all believers, right? The 12 tribes, as well as the 12 apostles, is a representation of all believers across all time. One of the rationales for that is later on when we get to Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, you'll see that they're all singing of how every tribe and tongue and people group and nation are all in awe and worshiping God. So it's as if John is being transported. And remember, he's trying to figure out what is the experience from the present reality to the future reality of the rewards. In the moment before, Jesus is knocking at the door, but in the moment after, the door is already open and he's seeing what's there. And what's there is the community of the believers surrounding the throne. And in addition to that, we have these characters found in verse 6. And who are these characters? The four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature is like a lion, the second like an ox, and like a human, and like an eagle. And where does this imagery come from? If the 24 elders can represent the body of believers that are worshiping God, what do these four creatures represent? Well, they could very well represent, as they do in the Old Testament, the angelic beings. So Isaiah chapter 6, Ezekiel chapter 1, Daniel chapter 7, all of these passages give us different glimpses of what seems like this same very setting that John is in right now. These are angelic beings, and again, it's very difficult to describe them. Ezekiel sees these creatures, and in his version, Ezekiel sees these creatures as having four faces each. And guess what those four faces are? Well, it's a face of a lion, of an ox, of a human, and of an eagle. So Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 10. And these creatures have six wings, according to the book of Revelation. Who else told us that there are these angelic beings that have six wings? Well, Isaiah, in his vision of the heavenly throne room, sees the throne being surrounded by seraphim. And these seraphim have six wings. Let's not get into all of those nuances. There are different interpretations, perhaps, as to the meanings behind the ox, the lion, and the eagle, and the human face. But let's just leave that for a moment and acknowledge what's plain and simple, that this is the representation of the heavenly beings, the angelic beings. And what are all these beings doing? They've been doing it for a long time now, because Isaiah in his vision saw them saying the same thing: holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And here we are, hundreds of years later, and they are still at it. They are without ceasing, day and night. And please understand, time is something that human beings can understand. But when we're talking about the eternal realm, time does not have the same kind of capacity that it does in our realm. So even when John is writing day and night, without ceasing they sing, later on we'll realize that there is no night anymore. Right? So in the presence of God, there is only day, because there's only the light that shines off of the Heavenly Father and the Son. And so day and night is just a way of describing that this is perpetual, perpetual praise. Now, there's a difference, because there's a praise that is happening from the angelic beings. And then every time the angelic beings are praising God, there is this parallel response with the community of believers. These 24 elders are drawn into also worshiping God. And if you notice, their worship of God is more direct. In their worship of God, in verse 11, they say, "You are worthy, O our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things." The divine or the spiritual heavenly beings are praising God for his divine attributes. But it's the 24 elders who have a kind of special relationship with God, special relationship because they've experienced God in and through life on earth, in and through creation. For you have created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. So there's a praising of God because of his works that he has done. So you have a community that just appreciates God because he is God. Then you have a community that is in parallel, appreciating God and praising him because of actual experiences of God's goodness, of his creation that they've gone through. Now, this is what John is noticing just behind that door that was already opened. Now, when we get into chapter 5, the plot thickens. Here in chapter 5, there is, "I saw in the right hand of the one seated on the throne a scroll." And it's different depending on the Bible translation, and there's perhaps something to this. The scroll was written on the inside and on the back. Usually, you would not write on the front and the back of the scroll. You would just write on the front of the scroll. But it seems like God's revelation is so full that it requires writing on the front and the back. There are translations that may make us think that it's just writing on the inside and the seals are on the outside. Regardless, let's not get carried away by that. There is a hidden, enclosed message that is held in the hand of God, and it's sealed. It's sealed so that no one is able to understand what is the explanation or the meaning or the perspective of the things to come. This is similar to what we find in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16. So in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16, there also the prophet is told to tuck away this scroll, that this message should be hidden just for the people of God. And again, you have to go and read Ezekiel chapters 2 and 3 in order to see again how the prophet Ezekiel also was made aware of a scroll, except in his case, he got a chance to open it, and inside are distressing, disturbing things. Daniel chapter 12 is another great Old Testament reference that helps to give us more colors to see this passage in Revelation with. So we're being given a perspective now, and we're so close to getting that perspective of how we get from the present to the culmination of Revelation chapter 21 and 22, but we don't get to see it because it's sealed. And this is deeply disturbing for John, so much that he's overwhelmed and he starts to cry. He is filled with what seems to be sadness because he's so close to understanding, and he's told that there is no one worthy, no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth who is able to open the scroll and to look into it. And when he thinks that all hope in understanding the future is lost, an elder tells him who can open it. That is one of the believing members of the body of Christ tells him, do not weep. In verse 5, see, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its 7 seals. Let's pause for a moment. These are 2 more figures of speech. What is the lion of the tribe of Judah referred to? What is the root of David? If you want the references for that, Genesis chapter 49, verse 9 gives us the hint of this lion of Judah that is to come. The root of David is hinted at and mentioned of in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. Now, if you continue on in either of these metaphors, either of these titles, you'll realize that both of these titles refer to the messianic king who would bring the kingdom of God, but it would often be with the connotation of military might and power. These were strong metaphors, the lion of Judah and the root of King David. Right, so there was this idea, or at least John is hearing the elder saying one thing, that is the victorious, mighty, messianic king. He is able to open and reveal and give us a perspective of the things to come. Now notice something interesting happens, because he hears about the Lion of Judah and he turns around, and then what does he see in verse 6? When he turns in verse 6, he sees a lamb, but not just any lamb. He sees a lamb as if it had been slaughtered, having 7 horns and 7 eyes. We'll pause on that for a second, and which are the 7 spirits of God sent out into all the earth. Why is this so interesting? Because he hears one thing and he sees another thing. He hears about the power of a mighty ruler who is able to open the scroll, and he turns in eager anticipation, and instead he sees a slain lamb. But the slain lamb, actually, now when we go back and read the Old Testament with the lens of Jesus on, we're able to see how the Old Testament had been promising us all along of how the victory would look very different than the powerful, majestic victory that everyone had expected to see. It's through the death of Jesus and through the death of the Lamb that somehow makes him worthy and capable of opening the scroll. It's beautiful just to think for a moment that even his death defeats evil. And if his death defeats evil, imagine just imagine for a moment what the life of this lamb would be capable of doing. So anyways, we have the right person now who is able to open the scroll. And it's important to meditate on this a bit more because there's so many metaphors happening all at once. Why is it that the lamb is the only one capable of opening the scroll? Why couldn't it have been the image of the Lion of Judah? I think it's to convey to us, and to especially those seven churches that were enduring a time of severe persecution, that it's only through the crucified and resurrected life of Jesus can any of the future events begin to make sense. It's only when you see the full life of Jesus that you can then recognize that this is an encapsulation of the whole story of history, of how victory will truly be achieved, not through military might, but through death, through sacrifice. And we'll get to it later on. In several places, you'll see the people of God following in the footsteps of this slain lamb. Again, notice that what happens once this slaughtered lamb comes to take the scroll, immediately the 24 elders fell before the lamb, each of them holding a harp and a bowl full of incense. Could these things mean perhaps a sense of worship and a sense of prayerfulness? The harp is oftentimes used in a worship setting because of its musical capacity. And then we're told the bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And so you see the worship and the supplication of all the people immediately bowing down to this lamb. And then in verse 9, they sing a new song. We'll have to pause there, at least in terms of looking at the song. We're going to take the song next week. But notice that they're not singing the same old thing. There's something about the post-resurrection that makes us, as a community of believers, sing differently. We don't sing like the Old Testament characters sang. We don't sing like the people during Jesus's day sang. We sing because now we are able to capture a perspective of history and its unfolding in and through the life of Jesus. Now, there's so many more things that we can do with this, but just because in our church, we're going to be having First Communion come up soon. Imagine and just think of all the metaphors that are present in our First Communion service that overlap what's happening here. See, there is a scroll. There is a revelation that gives perspective of the things now and of the things to come that is being handed to a lamb. When our children come forward for First Communion, they kneel down, and after they're blessed, they are raised up and they are given into their right hand a Bible. It's as if we're saying that these young children, the ones that you would never expect, they're the ones who are going to conquer the world, because they're going to be the ones who are going to be the reflections and the imitations of this very slaughtered lamb. And so it gives an entire new perspective on the way we live our current lives. And we've said this from the very beginning. This book is not about predicting the future. This book is about giving us a perspective of the future that changes the way we live today. And so if you want to know how we get from the present to the now, we've just glimpsed a bit of it. We recognize that in and through the life of the slaughtered lamb is the key to understanding how victory can be won, even when it looks like everyone is losing all around us. So we'll pause there. Next week, we'll look into that song and we'll see the beauty of the gospel message in that song. And then we'll go into a whole set of seven seals, seven trumpets, and then ultimately seven scrolls. So we'll pause there and take any questions that you may have.